Welcome to this virtual worship service of Banner Elk Presbyterian Church. We had gotten very close to completing plans for the reopening of the church when the governor extended his order of stage two, in fact requiring masks, in my mind, made it go back to 1.9 actually. And the session has voted not to institute those plans until after, at least after that order expires. I do want to assure you that the virtual service will continue even after we reopen. Watch your email or the website so that you'll be on top of things as they happen. Today we'll continue our series of a look at our people in the book of Genesis, and today we'll be looking at Hagar. We also have a special anthem included in this service. It is a recording done from many locations around the world by international peacemakers that our church has been working with over the years. It is "This Is My Song," which is a hymn in our hymn book, number 340. It is a beautiful hymn, but on this 4th of July weekend, it is particularly appropriate. It celebrates the love of country, but it puts it in the context of a world where others love their countries just as much as we do. I learned after the fact that this effort was prompted by and produced by two good friends of mine, Carl Horton and Beth Mueller. So it is of even more interest to me, and you will see them as two of the singers. With that background, let's prepare our hearts to worship God.
Should not perish, but Good morning. Would you join me in our call to worship, reading responsibly? O Lord, our Sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. When I look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of them, mortals that you care for them? Yet you have made them a little lower than God and crowned them with glory and honor. Let us worship God. For God so loved the world that God gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. For God sent the Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Let us confess our need for God's saving love. Merciful God, creation groans, your creatures cry, but we turn away. We surround ourselves with noise. We are quick to excuse ourselves from responsibility. We are young. We are old. We are tired. We are busy. It is hard to imagine that we might make a difference. Life-giving God, wash us clean. Restore our imagination and our hearts. Let your courage and compassion flow through our veins until we love with abandon. And our hands reach out in blessing, for the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the children of God. Amen. In the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, God says unmistakably, once and for all, you are my own, you are forgiven, and I need you to be about my business in the world. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven, made whole, and set free to live a new life in him. Thanks be to God.
This is my song, O God of all. nations, a song of
The scripture readings today come from the book of Genesis, and one of them we read last week as we looked at Sarah, but this week we'll be looking at Hagar, who also is very prominently featured in both of these texts. The first will be Genesis 16, 1 through 15, and then jumping to chapter 21, and read the first 21 verses of that chapter. If you don't have your Bible, now is an opportunity to locate it. Let's join together in prayer as we approach the Word of God. Let us pray. God of the universe, as we listen to your Word, by your Holy Spirit, lead our hearts into the abundant life, that we might walk according to your ways, for the sake of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Hear now the Word of God as it comes from the 16th chapter of the book of Genesis. You will notice that the first passage uses the name Sarai and also Abram, and the second one, Sarah and Abraham, because in the interim, God has changed both of their names. Hear now God's word from Genesis 16. Now Sarai, Abram's wife, bore him no children. She had an Egyptian slave girl whose name was Hagar. And Sarah said to Abram, You see that the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Go into my slave girl. It may be that I shall obtain children by her. And Abram listened to the voice of Sarai. So after Abram had lived 10 years in the land of Canaan, Sarai, Abram's wife, took Hagar the Egyptian, her slave girl, and gave her to her husband Abram as a wife. He went into Hagar, and she conceived. And when she saw that she had conceived, she looked with contempt on her mistress. Then Sarai said to Abram, "May the wrong done to me be on you. I gave my slave girl to your embrace, and when she saw that she had conceived, she looked on me with contempt. May the Lord judge between you and me." But Abram said to Sarai, "Your slave girl is in your power. Do to her as you please." Then Sarai dealt harshly with her, and she ran away from her. The angel of the Lord found Hagar by a spring of water in the wilderness, the spring on the way to Shur. And he said, "Hagar, slave girl of Sarai, where have you come from, and where are you going?" She said, "I'm running away from my mistress Sarai." The angel of the Lord said to her, "Return to your mistress and submit to her." The angel of the Lord also said to her, "I will so greatly multiply your offspring that they cannot be counted for multitude." And the angel of the Lord said to her, "Now you have conceived and shall bear a son. You shall call him Ishmael, for the Lord has given heed to your affliction. He shall be a wild ass of a man with his hand against everyone and everyone's hand against him, and he shall live at odds with all his kin." So she named the Lord who spoke to her, "You are El Roy," for she said, "Have I really seen God and remained alive after seeing him?" Therefore the well was called Beer Laharoy. It lies between Kadesh and Bered. Hagar bore Abram a son, and Abram named his son, whom Hagar bore, Ishmael. Turning now to the 21st chapter, beginning with the first verse. The Lord dealt with Sarah as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah as he had promised. Sarah conceived and bore Abraham a son in his old age, at the time of which God had spoken to him. Abraham gave the name Isaac to his son, whom Sarah bore him. And Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. Now Sarah said, "God has brought laughter for me. Everyone who hears will laugh with me." And she said, "Who would ever have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age." The child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out this slave woman with her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." The matter was very distressing to Abraham on account of his son. But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah says to you, do as she tells you. For it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring." So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite him a good way off, about the distance of a bow shot, for she said, "Do not let me look on the death of the child." And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the boy. And the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy, and he grew up. He lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife for him from the land of Egypt. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's be clear about something from the get-go. This surrogate mother arrangement is not Hagar's idea. Not only that, she would have no say in the matter at all. She is Sarah's maidservant, her slave. And slaves have to do what they're told, even if it means consorting with a 75-year-old man. With apologies to 75-year-old men everywhere, I'm not long in joining your ranks. Slaves are seldom asked their opinion, and they know better than to offer them uninvited. Hagar has no choice. No choice. The whole thing is Sarah's idea. As discussed last week, it's been 10 long years since God promised descendants more than the stars in the sand, and they have yet to produce even one. What's the holdup? In that day, consensus had it that it would be the woman's fault. People would speak of a barren woman, but you didn't hear any talk of a barren man or a sterile man. Sarah's been on the wrong end of the gossip that either pitied her or blamed her for the sad state of things, lo, these many years. She's ready for that particular monkey to jump off her back. Besides, at age 65, she figures her biological clock has run down. So she resorts to a custom of the day that allows her to designate another woman to have her baby. And she picks Hagar. Abraham doesn't object. Insert your own snide comment here. So everybody, Abraham, Hagar, like it or not, goes along with Sarah's plan. I feel for Sarah. There have been times in my life when I felt like I was in a holding pattern that would not end. And this virus has us in something like that now. I've spent days, weeks, months, and on two occasions at least, years trying to figure out God's will in a particular instance. We know that God often expects some initiative in faithfulness. Is this one of those times? Is it not? Do something. Don't do anything. I know how it feels to reach a point where you think you need to do something, even if it's wrong, just to keep from going nuts. And maybe you know what that's like too. Sarah is definitely there. When Abraham complains to God that, as it stands, his heir is Eliezer, one of his slaves, God assures him that he will have his own son. But Sarah reasons that God hasn't said that it would be Sarah's son. She tries to figure out what God would have her to do and hatches this plan involving Hagar and Abraham, and she assumes God will go along with it. It makes me think of another Abraham, Abraham Lincoln. During the Civil War, it's reported that when a pious minister told Lincoln he hoped the Lord is on our side, the president responded, "I'm not at all concerned about that, but it is my constant anxiety and prayer that I and this nation should be on the Lord's side." Sarah tries to figure out what God wants her to do. But it's interesting that the way the story's told, she never asks God directly what God wants her to do. God and the promise are hovering in the background, of course, but more object than subject. Abraham speaks to God a lot in other situations. Later we see Hagar crying out to God, but Sarah is trying to figure it out herself. And Abraham, when Sarah offers Hagar to him, doesn't consult God either. Insert another of your own snide comments here. At this point, Abraham listens only to his wife, not God. And don't take the wrong thing away from that. It's not that we aren't to listen to our spouses. It's that God should always be in the conversation as an actor, not as a prop over in the corner. There's this flurry of activity, supposedly because of God, but it is not God directed. And that should give us a clue where it's headed. It seems to be working at first. Hagar turns up pregnant just as Sarah has scripted it. But Hagar goes off script immediately. She looks at Sarah with contempt. It's as though she's dangling a giant red easy button in front of Sarah's face and saying, "What's so hard about that, old woman?" Besides the fact that it's not kind to rub something like that into anybody, it's not prudent to show up someone who is not only your social superior, but has real power over you. Sarah has rank and she has authority. Sarah is the mistress. Hagar is a slave. Sarah is the wife. Hagar is the concubine. Little more than breeding stock, truth be told. She has embarrassed Sarah in more ways than one. Even though Hagar has no choice in the matter, by giving Hagar to consort with Abraham, Sarah elevates Hagar's status in the household. And Sarah is doing it to raise her own standing. If Hagar has Abraham's child through this arrangement, by custom, Sarah can remove the shame of her barrenness. She will have made way for an heir, even if not from her own body. And no longer would she be the brunt of murmurs of blame or pity under people's breath. But Hagar isn't following Sarah's script any more than Sarah and Abraham are following God's script. My Jewish Publication Society's translation reveals that Sarah's complaint is that she is lowered in esteem, not raised up. And when Sarah suggests that this is somehow all Abraham's fault, she still keeps God on the periphery as someone referred to, as someone to judge who wronged whom, but not consulted when making plans. She seems to regard God as a God of convenience, someone to call on to sort through messes, not someone who might avert them in the first place. So Hagar has not followed Sarah's script, just as Sarah and Abraham have departed from God. God will let you do that, you know. God will let you take matters completely into your own hands. God will let you talk more about God than to God. God will let you refer more to God than consult with God. Sarah and Abraham do take things into their own hands and drag Hagar along with them. And they shunt God off onto a deserted siding, and things get all mucked up. Hagar is not playing the humble servant, deferring to Sarah. And Sarah wishes she'd never set it all in motion. Sarah turns the whole affair back on Abraham, and he, stereotypical husband, figuratively running for the hills, gives her a free hand to deal with Hagar as she wishes. So Sarah treats her harshly. Harshly enough that Hagar runs away. We could say that she had it coming for looking down on Sarah. We could say that she had it coming for not remembering her place in that particular society at that particular time. And that's true, at least in part. But Sarah and Abraham create the circumstances that blurred the lines, the circumstances that put Hagar into a situation she hadn't asked to be in and couldn't handle appropriately. Hagar runs away, and an angel of the Lord finds her by a stream. The story often says angel, but the person who sees the angel usually realizes that it is a manifestation of the Lord himself. He addresses her by name and by her standing. Hagar, slave girl of Sarai, where have you come from and where are you going? Hagar readily admits that she's on the run from Sarah. And the Lord tells her to go back to Sarah and submit, which would have to have been a hard prospect, but there is something to soften it. God makes a promise to Hagar that's an echo of the one he gives to Abraham. You're going to have so many descendants that you won't be able to count them. You will have a son now, and you will call him Ishmael because the Lord has given heed to your affliction. And so God blesses Hagar. This lowly slave girl, dragged without choice into a scheme, unwitting though it may have been, to subvert God's will, to get ahead of God, this involuntary surrogate whose life fell apart on account of it, this uppity servant who overstepped and made things worse, to her situation, God gave heed. God paid attention. Notice this. The God who one day would hear the cries of the Hebrews from bondage in Egypt also hears the cries of an Egyptian slave girl held in the promised land. And she would have a living reminder of how God gave heed to her affliction because the name Ishmael means God heeds. But God's not the only one to mark the occasion. Hagar realizes that she has seen God and, contrary to expectation, lived to tell about it. And she does something that I don't think anybody else in Scripture does. She names God. There are a number of times that God names people or renames people, like Sarah and Abraham. A sign of the divine giving them new life or new purpose. But this is the only time that I can recall of a human being naming God. And that it's a woman doing it's all the more remarkable. It doesn't mean that Hagar has authority over God. It doesn't mean that she is anyway defining who God is for all time. It doesn't mean, I believe, that there, it does mean that there is an intimacy to this encounter that Hagar wants to preserve. It does mean that a relationship has been established that was not there before, that Hagar wants to keep. You are El Roy, which means God of seeing. Have I really seen God and stayed alive after seeing Him? That's how she will remember Him. God of seeing. The God she has seen and who has seen her. It's a bit ironic that the ones who supposedly had the deepest, strongest relationship with God, Abraham and Sarah, after all, God had called them out of all the families of the world. In this instance, they're the ones that keep God off to the side. Yet the one who was a lowly slave, a foreigner, an uppity overreacher, ends up with a most intimate encounter with God. We could argue that it's even deeper than Sarah's, which always seems to come through Abraham. Hagar's social status in the household doesn't matter to God. Her status as a runaway doesn't matter to God. The things that she may have done wrong don't matter to God. God has come to her. She has conversed with God. She has seen God with her own eyes and lived. She has experienced a positive relationship with God, and I believe that that relationship is what gives her the wherewithal to go back and face Sarah, to submit once again, because she can see that there is divine purpose in it. Because she knows that God will be watching over her, this God of seeing, and watching over her unborn son. Of course, we know that doesn't end the matter. After the birth of Isaac, Sarah's own son, Sarah becomes jealous of Hagar and Ishmael once again. Not that it ever really goes away. All it takes is for Sarah to see Ishmael playing with his half-brother Isaac at Isaac's weaning party, for Sarah to announce that she wants Hagar and her son to have no part with the rest of the family. Sarah insists that Abraham drive Hagar and Ishmael out of the camp into the wilderness. Reluctantly, he does, after God lets him in on the promise that he has already shared with Hagar, that God will make a great nation of Ishmael as well as Isaac. And he sends them into the wilderness with only a skin of water and a loaf of bread between them. The water runs out. Death seems imminent. Interestingly, I notice that there are no cries for help to the God that Hagar has dared name, the God with whom she has related so intimately. She asks only that she not have to watch Ishmael die. I also notice that she finds herself in a position similar to the one in which Abraham will find himself a few years later, when God asks him to give up Isaac, the only means of fulfillment of God's promise to be sacrificed on Mount Moriah. If Ishmael is to die, God's promise to Hagar that he would be a great nation dies as well. Still, no cries for mercy for him or for her. Neither will Abraham ask for deliverance for him or Isaac. Is that because trust has run so deep that even though they can't perceive it, they give what they love most in the world over to God whose purposes cannot be thwarted, even by death? In this story, it's Ishmael whose cry the Lord hears. Ishmael, who has no doubt been reminded that his name means God heeds. Ishmael, who likely has heard the story around many an evening campfire of his mother's seeing God as a runaway slave. And in a new flurry of seeing, the Lord opens Hagar's eyes to a well that can sustain her and Ishmael, even as the Lord will open Abraham's eyes to the ram in the thicket to take Isaac's place on the altar. Sometimes we try to force God's hand. Sometimes we get ahead of God. Sometimes other people try to get ahead of God and we get dragged along with them. But in this story, we see God cultivate faith in the lowly, the victim of circumstance, the one who steps out of bounds, just as surely as God cultivates faith in his chosen ones. God sees all of us and lets us see God. And therein lies our hope and the hope of the whole world. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Let us join together now in prayer. Gracious God, giver of life, you know the complicated histories that have carried us to this moment. You know the names of all our generations, for you were there in each story of falling away and turning to home. You are there in each story of our long years of wandering and in the shining moments when we recognize your presence and find the grace to worship you. You are stranger neither to the striving nor the listlessness of humanity. All of creation is groaning, and so we dare to ask that you would come to us. Be born again in this place, in the midst of our boredom, our self-congratulation, our clouded vision. Startle us with your presence, that we will not be restrained. Strengthen us in the fruits of your Spirit and teach us to pray with confidence. We pray for all who flee from pasts by which they're haunted. We lift up all who feel abandoned by a future for which they had hoped. We plead for all who don't know that they are loved and chosen. We intercede for our own divided souls. Help us to trust that you are at work in every mingled heart, every conflicted community. Today, hear our prayers for those known to us who have particular needs and whose names that we can lift up now. May they sense your presence and name you as the source of their comfort. Nourish the life that you plant within us, O God, that we might keep seeding the world with your truth and your grace. In the name of Jesus, who gave his life for the sake of the world and taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The hymn is God of the Ages, Whose Almighty Hand. You have been seen by God. May you see God wherever you go. And go in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, knowing that you are loved and held dear now and forever. Amen.